Now what I'm going to do here is I'm going to just cut here and here, just so when I start taking my knife and getting a little knife happy here, I want to make sure that I got that already pretty well in, so I won't forget and just get a little too knife happy. Okay, and away we go. Now we're going to round off the, let's start with the wing a little bit here. And it's going to kind of roll in as we cut. Same with the back, is going to go back towards each other and roll in. You're rolling and taking the, here, and we're taking out the saw marks at the same time. I don't want to get too rounded on this edge here. And then get out of there. And I just want to put a little dent in here just to get our bearings here. Bearings. Same on this side. This is still my digging knife. I wonder if I can do better with my bigger knife here. And we're just rounding. And then this goes in. And taking the saw marks off. And I want to do the other side, which is going to, here's going to be kind of the funny thing, is that not only we're going to round and start taking some of that tail off out of there, where it started to draw. And of course, you know the rules of be careful, don't take too much wood off right away. You can always take it off later. I'm sure you all heard that a million times. So I'm gonna cut in like this, kind of like what I did with the tree. Stop cut and make this kind of a knife V-cut. Get out of there. Oh, I didn't put the, you know what, I forgot to put my 7-9. Don't mind this piece of wood. This is actually a sort of a leftover or something. I'm hoping it. And of course, when I paint it brown, that brown is not going to show, so. I've actually used my grinning, was a grinning pumpkin or scared pumpkin, and I had a piece like this. I don't know if I showed you that. And it came right down the face, and I kept it in there as sort of like a scar. That's what his name was, a scar. So it actually was not a bad thing. It was a good thing to have in there. And again, I got my finger and thumb on my thumb. And again, that brown isn't really going to show because it's going to be brown paint, and it's about where he's going to be landed, and it's going to be in the back. That does kind of get to me. I don't know if it gets to you how you end out of the way. You make your cut and it just don't come out. But that's what I wanted. I'm and just make a little scoop right there where the body is. I'm going to come up a little bit because what's going to happen is the body is bigger than the head. Sort of. Actually, it's really not. But we're going to make a dent where the neck is going to be. Let's get rid of some of that. But we will get to it. We start doing the head. I just want to get the body going. And we got a good start on this side. Again, we're going to be cleaning up and making sure we go the right direction, cleaning up and... But let's do this on the other side. Now we're going to sort of be mindful of that beak. Get some of that out of there. And the other thing too is I do like holding on to rounder things. I always like to get that corner off as best you can there. I don't know if I can chatter at the same time with carving. I remember the first time I ever saw a long-eared owl. It's like a small version of a great horned owl. And one day in the woods, I was going through and needed to take a break, and me and my friend and my dog. Nice sunny day, kind of darkened in the forest there, and just kind of found a nice tree and sit down against and just laid back and just relax and let my eyes just relax, and where my eyes set. Bullseye right on this this long-eared owl just staring right at me. You know, those big yellow eyes with the big black pupil staring straight at me. Scared the heck out of me. And then, of course, you know, I got to tell my friend, you know, shh. And we sat and we watched him for a while, and then there's our dog just kind of got up and kind of went around by the tree. No, get out of it. No, you're going to scare him. And the owl just kind of stared right at down at the base of the tree, and then after a while, and we got kind of our fill of looking at him, and time to get up, and we walked up. We even got all the way up to the tree, and which was about probably 12 feet up, staring down at us, and even though he was kind of banging on the tree a little bit, and, no, he wouldn't budge. He just kept staring right at us. That was incredible. Only time I've seen a long-eared owl. Well, there's my owl story. Well, speaking of, I'm starting to round out the head just a little bit here. I think it's time to get my bigger knife here. I don't think I ever have ever seen. Yeah, I think once I saw a snowy owl. Like I've mentioned before, I am from Minnesota, and as a matter of fact, the University of Minnesota has probably the biggest well-known raptor center at the University of Minnesota. And that was somewhat, I'm sure, probably forgotten by now. I mean, there's about a few. Let me get around the ear there very carefully. The ear is going to kind of come back like it's being breezed a little bit. And there was somebody found a snowy owl. I don't know where. And as the news guy was saying, and it was brought to, and before he had a chance to say, I said, it's the University of Minnesota Raptor Center. And that's exactly what he said. They fixed the owl right up and let him go. Now, the other thing that I've known that somebody else has told me about and I don't know if it's true about snow owls, snowy owls. I mean, you mostly see them perched on telephone poles, you know, out in the field. But I was told that they are a field bird, and they're usually on the ground and not in a tree. So that's why my tree, having him sitting on top of the tree, that snowy owl was not the right deal. Okay, now I'm gonna just put a little dimple right here, kind of separate the body from the tail. I'm gonna bring the tail back a little bit, same on this side. That's really fun where I went in, only 2 hours away from Duluth, Minnesota, where during the fall time we have our little Hawk Ridge there in the Superior in Duluth, where you go up this hill and there's a spot where you can watch all the raptors come down, like in September, October, for some reason. I mean, when they go north, they just go as fast as they can north, I guess, to set up their nests and all. But when it comes time coming down, they just seem to all come right at that Superior area. And I've been up there a couple times with my binoculars. I'm going to take this. Like I said, I think I could have gone to the saw, I suppose, to whack that off. And I hope you don't get too frustrated with some of my videos as I kind of change things around, because I'm kind of more of a, I like to learn my own stuff. I mean, I've got to a point where I'm not too much at doing other people's patterns, and I'm trying to learn to do my own. As a matter of fact, I just put on the up on the internet there. I'm gonna kind of round the neck just a little bit here. A presentation I did at our Lake Area Forest Lake Club about creativity and how you can start to be a creative person. So check youtube.com/ Scott Carvings. What am I talking? You're going to see that here anyways. That's probably where you got this from. I wasn't thinking. Kind of thinking about what to do here. Keep rounding. And it's more like a matter of you keep shaping. Now, what I want to do is I want to start getting the saw marks off the bottom here. Pencil marks. Make sure everything is rounded as best. Now, I want to not take too much. What's going to happen is I am probably going to end up cutting this flat again, and then I'm going to cut this kind of flat, or flat like this, probably like that. There we go. And you will see that the reason why we don't want to get this too thin right away is we want to be able to drill a hole so we can put a dowel in and drill a hole here, and so that will fit on there. And then once you get the hole drilled, then you can kind of play around a little bit with this, that, and the other thing.